until recently, I was the chief executive of the Game Developers Association Australia. So my job for 9 years was to take care of the games industry in Australia. And at the start of last year, I decided that it would be my last year at the GDA. And yeah, as good fortune would have it, I got a call from Epic halfway through the year saying, hey, we have an idea for you. So I've been really, really fortunate. My career has taken me all over the world. And my start was as a 12-year-old kid programming in my lab. But there's something I want to make clear, because we talk a lot about how we got into games, right? Everybody's path is different. And you're going to hear that today. We all have a different way of getting into the industry, and sometimes it's not the most conventional way. And that's something you need to keep in mind as we talk through what it is to be in the games industry. What is Epic? Okay, so contrary to popular belief, I mean, Epic Games is quite a brand now. We're actually a pretty small company. I mean, there's only like 1,200, a little over 1,200 people now, which contextually is actually really small in the games industry. It's a very, very close company. We're like this really weird little family thing. Everybody knows pretty much everybody. We talk to each other all the time. I have to do everything I want. You can see all the notifications coming from my computer and my phone. Our philosophy is be humble, be low-key, and help people. That's all we do. That's the job, that's the task from the top. Just help people where you can. So in the industry, we're most well known for the Unreal Engine. So the Unreal Engine is kind of the technology that powers most of the big games you probably play. Who said they played Mortal Kombat 11? Unreal Engine, thank you. So that's awesome. PUBG, if you played PUBG, if you played Rocket League, and yeah, we just bought them. I know, so there's that. If you played Spyro, who's played Life is Strange? Thank you, that's our real legend. So yeah, we used a lot in a whole variety of ways. And we've been pretty fortunate, so that's given us the opportunity to give back to the community. And that's kind of like Epic's way. So we created the store last year, and the store is obviously like most stores that you know, we sell games through. The only difference with ours is that we give more percentage back to the developers. So developers get more money back for the work that they've done. And this came from online. This came from my boss, Tim Sweeney, the guy who runs Epic. He just wanted to see more equitable distribution to people who actually create. We also have a whole bunch of online tools that we've created to help launch, manage, and scale big games. We've created for very specific game, and because we've had that fortune, we create online services, and so we give that stuff away for free now. So pretty much between Unreal Engine and online services and all the content in our marketplace, we're giving a whole bunch of stuff away for free. And yeah, let's be honest, those tools and that good fortune came from a little game called Fortnite. So yes, I have not played Fortnite. There it is. Not my kind of game, so yeah, not very observed when nobody put their hands up, it's actually kind of cool. I do, however, have t-shirts. So if you ask questions, you get this really punny t-shirt. And I think there's other things to give away, but yeah, if you want an orange t-shirt, okay, so there's that little over 250 million people playing Fortnite right now. And like I said, it's given us a lot of opportunities. It's given us, I'm trying to speed up too much of the time. It has given us a lot of opportunities to give back to the community. So aside from all the free stuff we do, something you may have seen in the news in March, we announced that we're giving away $100 million across a multitude of things. So if you're making really interesting games, there's funding for that. That's the obvious one. But we're actually doing a lot more than that. We're looking into the teachers and to the city of Ballarat. You probably should pay attention to this, because we're looking for educational products. We're looking for interesting uses of technology, looking forward. We're not interested in kind of what's happening right now. We want to know what's coming. We want to see technology in education. We want to see it embedded more. So the city planning, use tech, that's what it's for. So we gave away $5 million last year. That was our kind of little testing thing. $100 million announced this year, because why not? One thing people don't know about the big F over here is everything we do in Fortnite goes back into the Unreal Engine. We hide nothing. you could actually take the Unreal Engine right now, you could download it because it's free, and rebuild Fortnite if you wanted to, because everything is in there. We keep nothing to ourselves. Also, who's played Fortnite on mobile of the Fortnite days? Okay, so the guy that did that, he's in Australia. That's Jack Porter. He pretty much did it almost single-handedly. He now lives in Korea with his family, but Jack did that train. He's from Brisbane, which kind of still counts. But yeah, that was all Jack. I love this theme. Last year it was the clear standout for those wanting more, but it actually took me down a bit of a rabbit hole because I started thinking about what that actually means. Because more means tomorrow, doesn't mean today. And there's two kind of concepts I got stuck on. Where's the games industry going? And how does that relate to the kind of exceptional talent you're going to see on the stage today? And honestly, you're going to see some amazing people. You're going to get an insight into the complexities of making a game and the skills required to do exactly that. But the thing is, game technologies and game design and techniques, they've been used way beyond games now. And I kind of feel, I wonder if it's still accurate for us to say you're getting into games, because the people on this stage today and the people who are over there, they now have opportunities far, far beyond games. Who here is actually thinking about getting or having a career in the games industry? Okay, that's more of you than I thought. You're going to like one of my slides. Because I actually want to talk to you about them all. That's what I want to do, because it's the thing that intrigues me. It's what I get to do on a daily basis. And I am going to do it in the context of the Unreal Engine, because that's where I work. This is the side of the business of Epic that I work on and I love, and every single day of my job, I see them all. It is the most phenomenal place for me to be. So there's all these extraordinary things being made. So, okay, here's the deal. Everything you're about to see and everything I'm about to talk about is Unreal Engine related. It's using our tech in some form. But to be fair and to be clear, there are a lot of technologies out there. The thing you need to remember when you're actually looking towards your own futures, technology works for you. You choose the technology that's best for you, or make it yourself. Don't make a game engine. Jesus, hard. And it's a lot of money. But make technology work for you. So people who want to make games. So games, this video is, can you see that all right? Good luck, okay. So I mean, games are just stories, right? They're an opportunity for us to express, to tell a story, to deliver an experience. That's what they are. It's a medium of delivery, much like books, etc. This is Nick's game. And I wanted to highlight this especially because it's called The Forgotten City. Nick was a lawyer. He made a mod for a game called Skyrim. I'm assuming most of you probably played Skyrim. And he won an award for it. He won a writing award for it. But this was the story he wanted to tell. Now, what's interesting about this one is that Nick is one person. He decided to make this game. Now, it looks like a massive team has been behind it. But this was all Nick. This was one person. Also really interesting, Nick is from Ballarat. He went to Mount Clear Primary School and then St. Patrick's College after that. And this was his dream. So he pursued it. This is what following your passion is all about. This is something you really want to do. You can actually start. So all those hands that went up earlier, you can actually start this today if you want to. Do it. It is so, so worth it. Right. Now I'm going to go into the more, because this is the part of my job that is astonishing. So, game engines have been used in architecture and interior design. So if you're looking at beyond what games are, you're still looking at games. Because architectural design and visualization, these are just telling stories. The only difference is, you're telling that story before a single brick is laid in a building. You can walk through, you can convey a tone, you can convey a feeling in an environment that looks pretty damn real from the get-go. You can shape the entire experience of a space. And you start, it's interesting for me because I've never looked at architectural visualization in the past. In the past you would have seen photographs or a render what something could look like. Now you see it in a whole different way. I start seeing textures in bricks. I see light and shadows reflected on polished concrete floors. I look at those curtains and think, wow, those are ugly. I don't look at them because they don't want them. But you start seeing things, you start seeing the world in a whole new different way. So if you have those design thoughts and aspirations, this is a great space to get into. Also, let me be clear, coming from the games industry, when people are building these buildings and these environments and these beautiful cities and not blowing them up, that's really weird to get your head around. Like, it just seems like, blow the things up, just have a go. Like, we can. Next one, simulation. Okay, we can talk for days about simulation because this is super interesting. It's simulation in healthcare, simulation in education. Yes, defense is included, training is included. There are all these spaces you can go in simulation. What's interesting to me about simulation, and this is for all the problem solvers in the room, simulation you are never thinking about today. You are always thinking in the future. And that's a really cool space to be, because you're thinking about what the problems of the future are going to be, and then trying to solve them. And it's something small, like a city space. I don't know, that's quite dark, actually. I mean, this was a complete remap of the favelas in southern Brazil. This was done as an art project because the architecture is amazing, just so diverse. But now imagine it from the point of view of, what does it look like to have people walking through there? What does that space look like? How does that flow? How do you make that area better for the residents in it? What impact is it having on the environment around it? That's what simulation does. I mean, or if you're into chemistry, simulation is now creating new chemical compositions for drugs. But there's so many places you can go with this. Oh, what a motive. I do really love this video. This is one we did with Porsche. I just realized it's a bit colorful of it. Okay, imagine for a moment you can walk into a Toyota showroom. And you could sit down behind a touchscreen, and you could completely configure the car you want to buy. So the seats, the dashboard, the lights you want on the front, all the fairings, etc., etc. Pretty cool, right? Pretty cool to do. Okay, so here's the thing, you can already do that. So there's a studio in Sydney called Rota, already made that app using our tech, and that's rolled out to every Toyota showroom around the world. You can already start configuring your cars. In fact, I can't play it, but if you get to the end of this video, it goes into the Porsche configuration, which does exactly the same thing. So that's today. So what does most automotive look like in the future? What is it cars are going to need? How are you thinking about the user experience of driving or being in a car? More importantly, what's the user experience when we're not driving anymore? Like, what do cars look like when we don't have to drive them anymore? These are all things you can create and play with in a game engine environment. Broadcasting. I put this in for Anna, who's going to be talking later on, because she loves League of Legends. She also has a Twitch stream called The Angry Games. Just watch it. It's really good if you love League. Also, there's a language warning in that one. She can. We're changing the way people look at broadcasting, at TV, and online broadcasting. We can put things into a scene that a typical audience wouldn't see. We can inform more. We can create new experiences by building these things into a live broadcast. I don't know if you've seen the Weather Channel, did a whole bunch of features on floods, tornadoes, when they were going to the US. They actually sat on a virtual set. This is called virtual production, by the way, and built entire scenarios around themselves. So you watch the floodwaters rise next to the, alongside the presenters. You watch the poles. We actually, I think, dropped a car, one of the presenters at one point in the tornado one. Like, there are different ways that we can communicate now using game engine technology. And so that's the way you need to be thinking. It's like, what's next for TV? Because TV can be kind of boring. I'm not going to talk about Game of Thrones, because that's really cool. But yeah, there is more, a lot more to come. Yeah, please make TV better, that'd be cool. And the final one is almost the obvious one, is film. Film is changing, the way films are changing. Yeah, we've been really fortunate that we've had the opportunity to work on really cool movies. Who's seen Star Wars Rogue One? Ah, cool. Remember the big, tall, grey robot, K2? So K2 was actually rendered live on set through the Unreal Engine. The actors couldn't see it, but the director was watching a screen with K2 in the scene. And it was actually just a test for us, but it ended up being that good, it just stayed in the movie. So when you see K2, that's all us. These are things you can now do in the Unreal Engine. In fact, you can get together with your friends in a thing called Sequencer, and you can all work on a movie. One of you sits in VR, you can actually act out the thing. The other can be in VR as well, as a director and an editor, moving stuff around the environment. And there's a third person just actually editing, rewinding, retaking, etc. You can do all that. This is actually Troll. Really hard for you to see. It was done by Goodbye Kansas in the Deep Forest. with the leisure bike in there. So this is all model. This is really hard to see because it's cropped up. It is beautiful. So animation is another option that you can go down. It's a lot simpler to do now. The game engine. There's actually one of my favorite things is you wouldn't have heard of this. It's a full feature film called Ballarat and The Legend of Marco. It was made by a team of 40 Pakistan. Not exactly known for its animation films. It is beautiful and was done entirely in engine. That's what these technologies are doing. They're opening up worlds. Okay, actually you'll see a really short snippet of Ballarat in the thing. I can't go on, but I want to leave you with something. I'm going to play a clip now that I'm hoping brings everything together for you. And I'm kind of really hoping this maybe sparks something a little bit different for you in the way you're thinking about games now. Because the thing is, you know, I look here at the previous game. So, by the way, if you want me after this, I'm going to be in the layout. You know, we see all the stuff on screens around the world, and the same with the clip we're about to see. But this is the thing that drives us, this is the thing that motivates us every day while we wake up in this industry, is we want to see your work on a screen. So I'm hoping this brings it all together. Maybe you're thinking a little bit differently. Yeah. So have a look at this. Please accept. Do something awesome. It's all there, but it's all there waiting for you. Like, this is what we want to see. We want to play your stuff. We want to see your work. Start today. Like, you've got nothing to lose. Just go for it. That's me. Thank you. Anybody want to ask a question? We have time. Have I gone on too long? Anybody? Come back to you in a sec, because you're the old one. So, yeah. Shoot.
With Unreal Engine, can you possibly, like, a real-time animated car
sensor? Okay, so the question was, in the Unreal Engine, could you make a full-blown animated car? My answer is absolutely yes, definitely yes. We've got quite a few race names, there's configurators, yeah, it's been done already. So if you go to the Unreal Marketplace, we've got tons of assets. We give away a lot of free assets every month, and quite often we have a load of stuff in there. Just grab it. So if you do go to the Unreal store, we made a game before Fortnite really took off called Paragon. You might have heard of it. Every single asset for Paragon is on the store and it's free. You can take it, jump in, change the entire game if you want to. Everything is there, all the character animations, all the environments, everything is there. Also, I should mention this really quickly. So we have a thing called content examples in the Unreal Engine. It's a massive library of examples of how physics works. There's a maths hall. If you're struggling with things like sine and cosine and tan and etc., you can actually see all these things in action and understand how they work. So every part of game development is in the content examples. Also, if there's something you really like, take it and use it. Like, that's what it's for. Like, we don't, we don't mind. So, short answer is yes, you can make cards.
What do you think
So the question was, what do I think the success behind Fortnite was? Actually, I don't have an answer. What I will tell you, is actually what I say to guys on video down here. Whenever I'm in North Carolina and go to the Fortnite team, they're just super excited about what they're going to do next. They have these massive boards and they get genuinely enthusiastic about what it is. Like, hearing in the distance, the floor is lava, oh my god, yeah! And then it just goes. That translates into the game. And that's what Fortnite is. It's not, it's this really passionate team getting really excited about what they can do to make it fun, because they feel like it's going to be fun. And what you experience in Fortnite is that. And I think that's what comes through, is you feel this absolute love of the game that they work with. So that's, I don't know if that answers your question well, but that's what it is. Do you want a t-shirt, by the way? Yeah, a t-shirt? That's kind of where Tim founded the company. It was just him, and then it grew, Epic has very specific hiring policy and they are very similar people, so that was just why we get on. And it's kind of grown. And it's the reason if you walk into the Epic HQ in North Carolina, we have two big campuses. Everyone's wearing the Epic gear. Like, we actually wear this. It's not because we're advertised, but because we're walking billboards. We wear our gear with pride, and that's the culture that Tim created. I'm obviously wearing the Epic jacket, I'm wearing the Unreal shirt. There is something about building a company with that kind of culture where you feel just truly, truly close to it. And also, I get that he's a billionaire, but if you want to, you can look up Tim, what Tim's doing online. For those of you who play Fortnite and maybe bought some V-Bucks, Tim is now the largest landowner in North Carolina. He is actually buying huge forests to make sure that they never get developed. So he buys them and then he hands them over to Nature Conservation Society to make sure that we protect the environment. So this is why I work day and night for this company. Like, I love what we do to give back. Did you want an orange shirt?
Thank you.
So the question was, when you're making a character in games, do you sketch them out first, or do you just go straight to designing? You always sketch them out. So I don't want to talk too much about this because you're going to see Anna and Tessa talk about this. Their talks are amazing, and they're going to go through this entire process with you. But whenever we start in a game, we do not start with a line of code, we don't draw anything, we just pen and paper. That's all a game is. And once that starts working, that's when you actually sit down behind a computer and you draw a paper. Did you want to show? Cool. No, you're not allowed. Okay. How many more can I do?
Two more.
Two more? Okay.
Two more.
This will not solve everybody's problems. Like, that's no technology can do that. So you find what actually suits you. Yeah. Did you want to show? Sweet. Cool.
Yeah. I want to try and get to the back. I mean, there is something for that. Hang on.
Oh yeah.
So the question, So the question was, what are the problems you face making games? There are many problems. It is the most challenging industry to be in. Expect, and honestly, this is probably going to be repeated a few times during the course of this day, expect to fail, and fail a lot, because everything we do is always a test. Tim's got an amazing talk on design, and he's going to get into this a bit more as well. But there are so many things along the way, there are so many unknowns from the time we start a process to almost right to the end. There are things that happen that we just cannot prepare for, and oddly enough, that's what makes a game great. The more we fail, the better the game becomes. So it's kind of seems really counterintuitive, but failing is actually the best thing we can do for games. Can I do another? Oh, no, okay, thank you so much. Have an amazing day. I'm around for a
guys, this is the epic news. Tony Bridge, thank you. Play games, 5 minutes, off you go.